finally depart from here, do not depart from me. When I must suffer death, step forward next to me. When my heart is most full of fear, snatch me from my fears by the strength of your agony and pain. These words come from Paul Gerhardt's hymn, O Haupt voll Blut entwunden, O Sacred Head Now Wounded, written in 1656. The hymn's 10 verses describe the agony of Jesus' suffering on the cross and express the believer's resolve to remain faithful in all circumstances. These words, the hymn's 9th verse, are a plea for comfort and companionship with the divine. They solemnly admit that death will certainly come. They confess that the suffering and death of Jesus were meaningful, bearing the power to help the faithful in their hour of need, even today. This verse of Gerhardt's hymn appears near the end of J.S. Bach's St. Matthew Passion, and it is Bach's choral setting of Wenig einmal soll scheiden that inspired Richard Danielpour's piano fantasy, the subject of today's presentation. In the beginning stages of composing his piano fantasy in the spring of 2008, Danielpour recalls listening to St. Matthew Passion. The Passion had long been important to him, and he writes that upon hearing the work again for the first time in several years, I was particularly struck by the final chorale. It was then that he decided to quote the chorale at the end of his piano fantasy and create what he calls the effect of a set of free variations in reverse, in which the theme appears at the very end of the piece. Today we will look closely at this theme, the final chorale from St. Matthew Passion. We will begin by situating it in its context in Bach's oratorio and then consider its main musical features. This analysis will reveal the motives that Danielpour derives from the chorale to organize his 16-minute piano fantasy. We will trace appearances and transformations of these motives throughout the work, unearthing the considerable unity that permeates this ostensibly freely structured piece. Finally, we will explore how harmonic and motivic elements work together to articulate the work's major structural features. Bach wrote St. Matthew Passion for the Good Friday service of the Thomaskirche in Leipzig in April 1727. The work presents the events of Holy Week, culminating in Jesus' crucifixion on Good Friday, according to the Gospel of Matthew. The Passion features the complete biblical text of Matthew chapters 26 and 27, interspersed with recitatives, arias, and choral movements that elaborate on the emotions of the biblical characters and the theological significance of the story. 12 of these non-gospel movements are Lutheran chorale tunes that Bach harmonized for 4 voice parts. These hymns would have been familiar to the gathered worshipers, heightening their dramatic impact. The hymn that Bach uses most, 4 times throughout the Passion, is O Sacred Head Now Wounded. The final appearance of the hymn comes just after Jesus dies on the cross. Let's take a listen. You can follow along on page 2 of your handout. Let's take a closer look at this chorale melody. It is divided into 6 short phrases, the first 2 repeated. The melody is almost entirely stepwise, with 2 notable exceptions. The first is the opening ascending fourth from E to A, and the second is another ascending fourth from D to G in the final phrase. The interval of a fourth holds further significance for the chorale melody. Nearly every phrase has a range of a fourth. Only the first phrase extends to a fifth with its step from E to D. Every other phrase moves within that perfect fourth. The quote of Bach's chorale appears just over 12 minutes into the Piano Fantasy, but the preceding music, the free variations, as Danielpour hints, is deeply related to motives from the chorale. These motives are derived from the first five notes of the chorale, what I will refer to as the chorale head. Danielpour only quotes the complete chorale head a few times in the piece. When he does, its distinctive profile, an ascending perfect fourth followed by a stepwise descent, clearly draws the listener's attention. Here's an example from the very end of the piece, in which the right hand planes chords in the outline of the chorale melody. Appearance of the chorale head before the full quotation itself is the molto misterioso section, defined by constant trills in the high register of the piano. Here the tune is placed beneath the trills in the mid register of the keyboard to be struck by the fifth finger of the left hand like bell tones. Danielpour embeds the pitches of the chorale into the texture more opaquely through changes in rhythm and register. Near the beginning, the chorale melody is presented in the middle of the keyboard, accompanied by a bass line a tenth below. Here, the chorale's rhythm is distorted, stretched, its proportions changed. Breaks it down further into several distinct elements. The first of these is the initial ascending perfect fourth. The fourth appears in three ways in the piece: isolated, in a series of melodic fourths, and harmonically. One prominent appearance of an isolated ascending fourth comes about 5 minutes into the piece at the close of the first major section. The fourth appears in parallel tenths first ascending, then descending to the original pitch. Returns at the very end of the piece as well. This texture of tenths is likely inspired by Bach. Parallel leaps at the tenths do not appear in Bach's specific choral setting quoted in the piece, but they are found in earlier harmonizations of O Sacred Head, Now Wounded in St. Matthew Passion. Was listening to the Passion frequently in this season, these earlier settings of the chorale likely influenced the choice of texture, whether consciously or not. Melodic fourths also appear strung together in long series. This happens at the very beginning of the piece. Series of thirds related by fourth return periodically throughout the fantasy. Sometimes the direction of the fourth is reversed, as in this passage. In each of these instances, the result is something like a circle of fourths, mixing both perfect fourths and augmented fourths.
Mm-hmm.
also uses fourths harmonically, stacking up several into tall, tense chords. One example near the end of the piece evokes the tolling of large bells. Descends by step from A to D, finishing with a step up to E. The first four notes of the descent, an interval pattern of whole step, half step, appear several times through the work. Let's take a look at three examples. Early on, this minor descent is presented twice in the right hand, first in the middle of the piano, then an octave higher. The motive also appears in the brief poco misterioso before the leggero section. A sweeping gesture in the middle of the piano ends on an accented F sharp that becomes a trill, the other hand picking up the descending line. Descent is heard again in the double-stemmed bass line of the leggero section as the bass descends from C to G, then from F to C. Throughout the piece, we find many more instances of descending steps, but not all of them follow the interval pattern we've just heard. The very last measure of the piece is an example of this. The passage steps down through a fourth, but the intervals are slightly changed. Danielpour writes a descending whole step followed by a half step, then a whole step. This interval pattern is also found in the chorale melody. The initial descent begins from A, but starting from G instead creates a descent through a perfect fourth with the pattern whole step, half step, whole step. Though both sets of four notes have the same boundary interval of a perfect fourth, the descent from G to D alternates between whole steps and half steps, and thus constitutes the first half of an octatonic scale. This motive appears many times throughout the fantasy, beginning in the opening line. Let's take a look at two more appearances of the octatonic descent that all occur within the first 3 minutes of the piece. The octatonic descent is heard in the top voice of planing right-hand chords. And it returns a few moments later in the forte left-hand horn call that emerges from a peaceful texture. Another motive that Danielpour uses consists of an ascending fourth followed by a descending fourth, beginning from a step lower. This motive may originate as a simple inversion of the ascending fourth, but it also relates to the overall melodic shape of the chorale head. Bach's chorale ascends from E to A, then descends by step from G to D. This motive summarizes the stepwise descent, leaving out the inner notes, but keeping its boundary interval of a perfect fourth. The motive first appears early in the piece as part of the declamatory opening line. motive also appears in a bold statement in the final section, marked triple forte and martellato. Motive we'll discuss is really a family of motives. These are Danielpour's various permutations of the first three notes of the chorale. The chorale melody, as we've heard, leaps a fourth and then steps down. These notes are rearranged in at least five ways. What remains constant is the boundary interval of a fourth and a third note that is a whole step away from either end. The version that pervades the piano fantasy descends a fourth and ascends a minor third. I call this permuted head one. Danielpour uses it to open the piece, and it returns throughout at major structural moments. We just heard the opening line a few minutes ago, and then it also appears in the second line. As we discuss the larger structure of the work, I'll point out when various permutations of the head appear. Danielpour titled this piece Piano Fantasy, implying a freely structured work. He also describes it as free variations. Though the work moves through many sections of changing tempos and textures, the recurring appearances of the motives we've discussed help the work to remain coherent. The fantasy's neo-tonal harmonic language also allows for structural harmonic arrivals. The frequent use of symmetrical sets like the octatonic and whole tone scales sometimes muddies the sense of a tonic or centric pitch, but Danielpour creates several moments that can only be described as cadences to triads. These harmonic arrivals help group the work's many parts into four large sections, shown on the last page of your handout. In analyzing the structure of this piece, it made the most sense to me to begin at its defining moment, the direct quotation of Bach's chorale setting, which appears three quarters of the way through, about 12 minutes in. From here to the end comprises the final large section of the piece, as shown at the bottom of page 4 of your handout. As a fortissimo crash in the lowest register of the piano gradually fades to pianissimo, the chorale emerges, played triple piano, with the una corda pedal depressed. Danielpour presents it one octave higher than Bach's version and requires that the damper pedal be held continuously, lending the chorale a distant, blurred quality, as if heard from the other end of a large cathedral. A pianissimo bass octave punctuates the fermata at the end of the first phrase before the chorale proceeds calmly through its second phrase. Just as the cadence in A minor should arrive, a crude agitatissimo outburst erupts with wild octaves and chords in a grotesque quasi-swing style. It slams to an abrupt conclusion on a single A in the left hand that is tied over into the next phrase of the chorale, now entering pianissimo dolce espressivo. Danielpour continues this path, presenting the chorale phrase by phrase, each cadence followed by interjections, sometimes loud, sometimes quiet. These interruptions review many of the motives that have appeared earlier in the work. A low B-flat pedal persists throughout most of the section. After the final loud outburst, it settles down again with B-flat on the bass, bringing back the ascending fourth motive and ending with a B-flat triad followed by a gently unfolding arpeggio that extends to the top of the keyboard, saturating the sound with nearly the full chromatic scale, leading to the final octatonic descent.
Thank you.
conclusion, the fantasy has come to rest on B-flat both harmonically and melodically. This ending is foreshadowed much earlier, just under 5 minutes into the piece. Parallelism suggests to me that the earlier arrival on B-flat major marks the end of the first large section of the piece, which is the top bar on that page of your paragraph. Further evidence of the structural significance of this arrival is the quote of the fifth and sixth phrases of the chorale that immediately precedes the ascending fourth motive. As a reminder, here are those phrases in box setting. Here's Danielpour's quote of that phrase. This early juncture in the piece, as a whole, signals to me that this moment is a local ending, the conclusion of the opening section. This large opening section that precedes that B-flat arrival we just heard introduces all the motives we hear in the piece, particularly relying on the permuted head motive, which appears at the very beginning. It also heavily features the circle of fourths version of the fourth motive. It is expanded from thirds used in the opening measures to octaves with thirds, marked triple forte, drawing on the full range of the piano. As we just heard, B flat is in the bass for this massive arrival. B flat is then reinforced as the section dies down with the cadence that foreshadows the end of the piece. The following large section I've labeled diversions because it seems as if the piece may begin again with the opening ideas repeated, but instead moves into a varied series of new textures and tempos. After the arrival on B-flat, Danielpour attempts to restart, evoking the opening motive, but he soon trails off into the slowest and dreamiest moments of the piece. He uses a new permutation of the head motive, bringing the action to a standstill. From there, Danielpour launches into a quick leggero section with fleet septuplets leading to an enormous climax that evokes the circle of fourths chords earlier in the piece. Next comes the trill variation, and this is the first time that E-flat becomes a more centric pitch. The chorale head quote, which we heard earlier, is in E-flat minor, and the two sustained trills in the upper register suggests an E-flat triad. The trills spin out into a declamatory octave section that uses the permuted head motive and introduces dotted rhythms. This entire diversion section then comes to a close with a series of bell-like chords that ends with B-flat to E-flat motion in the bass, approximating a 5-1 cadence in E-flat. After this solemn arrival at E-flat, a fugue subject enters, combining four motives from the chorale. First, the permuted head, then the octatonic descent, followed by the summary motive, which is enlivened by dotted rhythms used in the previous section, and it concludes with another version of the permuted head. Exposition, but soon the strict entries give way to free counterpoint, using motives from the fugue. The energy increases with a subito piumoso section that combines the permuted head motive in the right hand with its inversion in the left. The momentum and drama build to the climactic maestoso, in which the permuted head is proclaimed triple forte from the top of the keyboard, answered by thunderous crashes in the bass. As these bass chords slowly die away, the chorale theme finally emerges. The quiet entrance of the chorale after the severe, decisive clamor of the preceding measures draws parallels to St. Matthew Passion. After the most tragic and consequential act of the Passion, Christ's death on the cross, this chorale begins, stepping out of the narrative in time and space to comment in gratitude and reverence on the moment's significance. While Danielpour's Piano Fantasy makes no claims to such spiritual significance, the expressive effect of the chorale's entrance is a revelation of order amid chaos. As discussed earlier, a B-flat pedal persists through nearly the entire section. Zooming out to see the larger harmonic plan, we can see that the opening section ends on B-flat, the diversion section cadences to E-flat, the key of the start of the fugue, and the final section returns to B-flat. The harmonic design of the whole piece is thus encapsulated in the fourth motive that appears at the end of the first and final section. The focus of today's presentation has been on Danielpour's Piano Fantasy, but I wanted to briefly introduce the two short pieces I've chosen to play today. They are from a collection of pieces called The Enchanted Garden. Danielpour wrote the first book of The Enchanted Garden in 1992, noting that the set was inspired by the juxtaposition of and contrast between subconscious dreams and conscious reality. Thus, the title of Enchanted Garden refers to the human mind. The second book was written in 2009, just after the Piano Fantasy. This time, the subjects of the pieces are actual memories that, when recalled, have a dreamlike quality. I chose two of the preludes to play today. First, Elegy, the third of the set. This beautiful piece features a constantly repeating D-flat that continues nearly unbroken throughout. It's a deeply expressive lament that exhibits Danielpour's fine sense of lyricism, which comes through in the Piano Fantasy as well. The next is Lean Cat Stride, the fourth in the set. This piece is an extreme contrast to Elegy. It's in a rowdy swing style with stride bass, boisterous dissonances, and a playful sense of humor. Its title comes from the nickname of Danielpour's wife, Kathleen. Its style is reminiscent of the crass outburst in the Piano Fantasy that interrupts the chorale at the end of its first phrase. In that context, it is irreverent and transgressive. But in Lean Cat Stride, it's all part of a good time. Taken together, these pieces show how masterfully Danielpour writes for the piano in a variety of styles. In the Piano Fantasy in particular, I hope you hear how Danielpour's love of Bach's chorale pervades the work and has resulted in an expressive and powerful piece that stands out in the 21st century piano repertoire. Thank you.